Would you rise as you're able and join us in this morning's call to worship? We gather together in a love that drenches us with God's goodness, so we may learn the lessons about God's love.
Lessons from our different homes and diverse backgrounds, how our concerns differ, as well as our gifts and varied talents.
We learn how God's diversity blesses us with gifts of varied forms, so we may use these gifts to nourish hearts with compassion.
This can only happen when we learn to place God before our pursuit of wealth, so we can nurture our spirits with awareness.
Learning the lessons of spiritual awareness is to know the many ways we can serve in the world. And in doing so, the gifts are used for good.
May your spirit teach us to be aware, O God. Renew our strength, inspire our generosity, and empower our love. Amen.
Amen. Now join Peter in our opening song.
I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. It's all right.
Thank you, Jesus. David, where you been? This is the beginning of church.
Yes.
Let's praise and pray together. Thank you, God, for this time we have together in this place. Thank you for all who are joining online today, who are worshiping. They're not just watching. They're worshiping. Because how can we not worship when this kind of spirit is moving all over the world? We ask that you continue to bless our lives today. Open our hearts, Lord. I think they're already open to everything you have for us. Let us feel that worthiness to receive everything that you have for us. We ask in the name of Jesus and all that is holy. Amen. 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 You may be seated. Good morning once again. We want to say welcome. We're so glad that you have joined us in worship today. As I mentioned just a moment ago, even a prayer, we want to welcome all of you who are joining us online. We know that you are worshiping wherever you are. And we just want to say thank you and just say we're glad you're here. We hope that you'll be with us more and more and more. We hope that soon those of you that are live near enough by will be with us in person. And we're so glad that you're here. We also want to welcome you if it's your first time with us, whether it's the first time online or first time in the house. If you are first time with us, would you just wave at me? It's good to see all of you here. And I also want to, amen. We also want to welcome all of you who are part of the in-house crew who work all during the week to make sure that we have service going, and then some that are working during worship time today to make sure that the broadcast goes out. So we just want to say thank you to all. We do want to share this moment that we have every week called Church Outside the Walls to share with you something that goes on outside the walls of this church that happens during the week. This week, we want to honor our card ministry. You will note that Glenn Payne Memorial Card Ministry is what we've been calling it. And you, some of you will remember Glenn Payne. We'll hear a little bit more about him in just a few minutes. Glenn Payne started this card ministry many, many, many moons ago. And those of you that have been around or probably ever even visited, if he got your address, you were going to get cards on your birthday and at Christmas, at least, and maybe some other times if he found out that you needed it. And I will tell you, sometimes it was hard to even read the card because there were so many stickers all over it, because that was our Glenn. He loved to put these little stickers all over it. And if he knew, here was the thing, if he knew things about you, like he knew I love dogs, he would make sure he had dog stickers on mine. And, you know, he was just so thoughtful. And after Glenn passed away a few years ago, several people took on that ministry. And I just want to say thank you to Pam Fairbanks, Leah Fulham-Body, and Art Fisher, who have carried on. They have continued to carry on that ministry. You say, well, I didn't get a card on my birthday. Well, then evidently we have some wrong information on you. So when the little books come down the aisle, make sure that you put the correct information in. And also, if you're not receiving our e-news, please put your email address there so that you can get it weekly. It comes out every Friday, so that you know all the things that are going on at the church. So make sure we have good information, correct information. Maybe you've changed some things since the last time we were together. And so you need to update that information. We just want to say thank you for continuing this ministry to Pam, Leah, and Art. Thank you so much for making, for just being faithful and making sure that Glenn Payne's card ministry continues to bless from Founders MCC. Would you give them another hand? We also have a few announcements for you this morning. First of all, this coming Tuesday night is our board meeting. We have open board meetings. It's online, currently on Zoom. It's at 6:30 So the Zoom link is in your bulletins. There we go. So it's Tuesday at 6:30. On Wednesday night, we're continuing in our study. I love this rights side up. And if you have been missing that, you have been missing a great treat. But don't worry, you can go back and look at it, because they are online. You can go back and see them on our church page, our founders' church page on Facebook. And so they have been very deep and very interesting. Lucia and Garrett have been leading us with special guests as well. So we invite you to do that 7:30. It's on Zoom and on Facebook Live. So you can catch them on Wednesdays at 7:30. Just to let you know, we did get information this week on Joel Wilsey's memorial, which will be October 1st. It's a Saturday at 1 o'clock at First Baptist Church in Pasadena. We'll put that information again, once again, the week before that happens, and in our e-news, so that you can get there if you want to. On October the 2nd, that's on a Sunday, we will have our next new members class. If you are interested in becoming a member of Founders MCC, or if you want to just know more about our denomination or our local church, we are called Founders MCC for a reason, because we are the founding church of a whole denomination. That ought to strike your interest, huh? And if you want to know more about that, Reverend Steve Swafford will be teaching that class. It will be online and in person. So if you come, you can join live. It's at 11:30, so it'll be after our 10 o'clock service and before our 1:30 service. That will meet up in the conference room, and it will also be on a Zoom link that we will share that week in our e-news. You notice we have generosity tree over here. People's like, what is this tree? It looks beautiful, and it's got all these rainbow colors on it. Well, you'll hear a little bit more about that shortly, about the different branches. But if you'll notice, there's a little bucket underneath. That bucket has some ideas for giving gifts. Our anniversary, our 54th anniversary is coming up next month. And so if you would like to buy a gift for the church, there are some gift ideas right there. Tells you how much it costs, where you can order it from, whether you can get it in the mail. You know, there's a lot of stuff you can just have delivered. And so it's right there. We've done a lot of the hard work for you, so just look. Varying prices, anything from $5 or $10 right on up to hundreds of dollars. And we would just love for you to take a look at those items. I saw several people up there digging in the bucket before service. I was like, praise the Lord. Right. I might have to go. We might be calling around to see if we need to put some more items in that bucket. Speaking of our 54th anniversary, we are going to do something special this year for our 54th. Now that we are able to come back in person, We want to have a just old, I'm from the South, we have old-fashioned homecomings. And on homecoming, that's where you invite anybody who's ever been a part of the church for any reason to come back home, because this is home. And so we want, if you look around, who's missing? Who did you used to see when you were here at church? And if you're worshiping online today, how long has it been since you've been in the building? Well, here's your opportunity. Start planning now. Of course, we're happy to have you next week, too. But in the meantime, be planning for our 54th anniversary. October 9th, we will celebrate. We want to have a big homecoming. We're having a special speaker. I'll give you more information about that next week. Little bit by little bit, we get information. And then we're going to have a catered lunch downstairs in our social hall and theater, and maybe even some entertainment. So we're looking forward. Now get word out. See? Some of you just all piped up when I said food. Catered lunch. Catered lunch. I don't have to cook and bring it. Now, the old-fashioned homecomings, they had to cook it and bring it. And I felt bad for the folks that cooked, because they were usually so worn out they didn't even want to eat after church. Some of you are shaking your heads. You know what that's all about. So this time it's being catered so you don't have to do all of that. Just come and enjoy and let's have a good time of fellowship together. It's a good way for us to come back as community once again and spend some time together. And we want to do exactly that. 54th anniversary, October the 9th. Comes time for us to pass the peace to one another. And so I invite you in the room to welcome one another. Watch for the little green stickers. The ones who have on green stickers are open to handshakes and hugs. The ones of us that don't. And if you're joining us online, if you're worshiping online, type in hello or peace be with you. Let us know that you are here and a part of this worship service. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Pamela Fairbanks, and I am part of your birthday ministry service that we do. Glenn, oh, there's so many, many things you could say about Glenn. Glenn was part of so many ministries in this church, but I'll say this. His love for the birthday card ministry gave him pure joy.
And he was wonderful, too.
Look at there you have it. Beverly sang that from the bottom of her heart. It's a ministry that he ran for over 30 years. I'm thinking closely to 40. It's a long time. Now, that's commitment in ministry. Many of us at one time or another would walk up to Glenn and hug him and thank him for the wonderful cards that he sent out to us. Me, myself, I say his birthday cards had happy feet. It made me so happy when I received a card from him. I mean, it just goes all through you. His cards were fun and they were loving and filled through and through with his love for God. He didn't let you forget that in the card too, because he always had some God phrases in there. He didn't let you forget how we got here. Yeah. Glenn knew that there were people in our congregation that never received birthday cards or a happy birthday wish from anyone. He knew that, and he wanted to do something about it. Why? Because they were estranged from their families or their former friends who did not accept them because they were gay. That goes on all these years later, still happening. Glenn wanted them to know that they were loved for who they are. And most of all, he wanted everyone to know that God loved them. So that was his piece to let them know that. So you guys, as Pastor said, if you haven't got one, it'll be coming in the mail. God bless you, and God bless Glenn Payne. We love you, guys.
Please rise as you are able for today's sacred reading. And our reading this morning is taken from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 16, verses 1 through 13. This translation is The Voice. Here is a parable he told the disciples. Once there was a rich and powerful man who had an asset manager. One day the man received word that his asset manager was squandering his assets. The rich man brought in the asset manager and said, "You've been accused of wrongdoing. I want a full and accurate accounting of all your financial transactions because you are really close to being fired." The manager said to himself, "Oh no, now what am I going to do? I'm going to lose my job here. And I'm too weak to dig dishes and too proud to beg. I have an idea. This plan will mean that I have a lot of hospitable friends when I get fired." So the asset manager set up appointments with each person who owed his employer money. He said to the first debtor, "How much do you owe my boss?" The debtor replied, 100 barrels of oil. The manager said, "I'm discounting your bill by half, just write 50 on the contract." Then he said to the second debtor, "How much do you owe?" The fellow said, 100 bales of wheat. The manager said, "I'm discounting your debt by 20%. Just write down 80 bales on this contract." When the manager's boss realized what he had done, he congratulated him for being clever. That's how it is. Those attuned to this evil age are more clever in their dealing with their affairs than the enlightened are in dealing with their affairs. Learn some lessons from this crooked but clever asset manager. Realize the purpose of money is to strengthen friendships, to provide opportunities for being generous and kind. Eventually, money will be useless to you, but if you use it generously to serve others, you will be welcomed joyfully into your eternal destination. If you're faithful in small-scale matters, you'll be faithful with far bigger responsibilities. If you're crooked in small responsibilities, you'll be no different in bigger things. If you can't even handle a small thing like money, who's going to entrust you with spiritual riches that really matter? If you don't manage well someone else's assets that are entrusted to you, who's going to give over to you important spiritual and personal relationships to manage? Imagine you're a worker and you have two managers giving you orders. What are you going to do when they have conflicting demands? You can't serve both, so you'll either hate the first and love the second, or you'll faithfully serve the first and despise the second. One manager is God and the other is money. You can't serve them both. Hear what the Spirit says today.
Of heights to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall through the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck, we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. lightning bolt where it should go. Or sing heavenly storehouses laden with snow. Who imagined the sun and gave source to its light? Yet conceals to bring us a coolness of night. One can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck, we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, untamable, you place your stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck, we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart and you know me the same. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God.
Amen. And thank you all, musicians. We appreciate it so much. Leading us in worship. Now, you may have noticed already the name of this sermon. You is smart. You is kind. You is important. You may recognize that either from a novel or from a movie. There's a 2011 movie called The Help. It's based on a novel by Catherine Stockett. It's set in the South, in Jackson, Mississippi, in the 60s, when the civil rights movement is just starting to get underway. And it's about a white high society girl who comes back home from college and she wants to be a writer. And she decides she wants to write from a different perspective. She wants to write from the Help's perspective. The Help was the African-American people that were servants in white households in the South. And she talks a little bit about, they tell us, we get all this information from them about what these servants were expected to do. The maids in particular. The men a lot of times did the outside work of keeping the lawns and the yards and the flowers and all of that. But the maids in particular, which is what this is based on, were the ones who not only did all the cooking and all of the washing and all of the cleaning and all of the shopping, but one of their main roles was to rear the children. They had to rear white children, sometimes leaving their own children at home for someone else to rear so that they could provide for their own children. And it's really fascinating to watch. In fact, if you go back, if it's been a while since you've seen the movie, go back and look at it. I looked at it again last night as part of my homework for this message. One person, and this is only one in the movie, but I'm sure this happened. The maid would sometimes be hired at a very young age, maybe even a teenager, and they were expected to serve that family for as long as they lived. And they may serve through several generations. And if they had a daughter, then the daughter would become, they would rear the daughter. And then the daughter would go to college and come back. And then the daughter would be the boss. So you're now being bossed by the person that you reared. It's very informational, very scary. She wanted to write Skeeter is her nickname, good Southern nickname. Not so much for high society girls, but that's what they did. They called her Skeeter. And she decides to write about it. She gets one maid to agree to talk with her. And then some of the other maids join in, and she eventually gets a book published. I think one of our favorite characters, can anybody remember? Who was your favorite character? Viola Davis. She was the lead. And then but the antics. There was something that involved a chocolate pie. And see the reaction that I'm getting even here. I bet you're getting that at home as well. Now, many of us applauded that chocolate pie and the special recipe. We applauded what happened with that pie, and maybe it was deserved. It was a very clever thing to do. Probably wasn't so smart to do, but it was very clever to do. Skeeter did something herself that involved changing the word coats to commodes. And lots of used commodes ended up on a very wealthy person's lawn. Again, it was very clever. It was probably very much deserved, but it wasn't very smart. She was never accepted with the high society anymore in that city, and she couldn't get a boyfriend after that. Clever versus smart. You mentioned Viola Davis, and I think it's important that in the children that she reared, she would always sit them in her lap and she would say these words and have them repeat it, because it became a mantra for them. No matter how bad their parents treated them, no matter how much they were ignored by their own parents, by their own blood, she would teach them to say, I is smart. I is kind. I is important. Some of us could have used that mantra growing up. How many of us would have probably been in a lot better place today had we heard that all of our lives, that we were smart? Because a lot of times people say, you're so stupid. And how many of us have said that to ourselves? We have to get out of that. You are kind. You are important. But I love that she turned it back. She would say, repeat after me, I. So that child would hear it in their spirit. They would hear it in their soul. I am smart. And keep telling yourself, I am smart. I am kind. I am important. And when you remind yourself of that, and I remind myself of that, it keeps me from a lot of trouble. When I was reading this scripture this week, I kept hearing those words. I is smart. I is kind. I is important. In the story, Jesus tells a parable about another servant, the help. He talks about the help. Says this asset manager's servant has been squandering the money, not doing everything he was supposed to. And then the servant finds out, the asset manager finds out what the servant's doing, and then the servant finds out what that the boss knows what he's been doing. So he decides, before I get fired, let me go and try to fix this and maybe it'll save my job. Because I don't want to change jobs. I like right where I am. I've come to enjoy right where I am. So I might not be living up to my potential. I might not be doing what I'm supposed to do, but I really want to stay here. How many of us have done that? And then he goes out and starts finding the debtors to his boss and rewriting the contracts, which is still not right. His boss was still going to lose money, some of it up to 50%. The 100 barrels of oil, anybody know what 100 barrels of oil are worth today? And then you go 50% of that, you're going to take that money away. Here's the funny thing. Jesus says he was very clever. The asset manager understood that the guy was clever, and he did at least try to get some of it back. So he gave him points for being clever. But Jesus said, I don't want you to be clever. I want you to be smart. You was smart. And I don't want you to squander it. I don't want you to go out and make all of these backhand deals. I want you to be kind. Why? Because you're important and you're making yourself less and less valuable every time you're just trying to be clever. Not so smart, but very clever. Now, I don't know if the rich man fired the guy or not. I have a feeling he did. But we did learn some things about generosity and about what Jesus was saying, and goes along with our generosity tree and the Glenn Paynes and the others that we've recognized. I love this verse, verse 9. Learn some lessons from this crooked but clever manager. Anybody know any crooked and clever managers? I've known of a few. Realize that the purpose of money, some of you have been wondering why you had it. Now you know. Realize that the purpose of money is to strengthen friendships. I don't mean the kind that are just there for the money. I mean friendships, because that ain't friendship. It might be some kind of relationship. It might be a business deal. It might be something that is not genuine and honest, but true friendships. True friendships. True friendships. There are cultures that have this whole thing. I used to tell Reverend Alejandro, if you go out anywhere with his Latino congregation, our congregation that is Latino, maybe I should put it that way. There's something about the Latin culture that if I have a dollar, we have a dollar. It's not just my dollar, it's our dollar. And we just keep sharing and keep sharing and keep sharing. And I love that about that culture. Some of us could learn that. Real friendship. It's to strengthen friendships, but it is also, and I love this, Jesus says it's to provide opportunities for being generous. It provides us with an opportunity. It's not just so I can go buy whatever I want, even though that's nice and we all like to treat ourselves, and there's nothing wrong with that. I'm not telling us that we can never, ever, ever have something that we want. But Jesus said it's not just for that purpose, it's to provide opportunities. Now, you're going to take the opportunity? Because I guarantee you there are opportunities all around us. Opportunities to be generous. To be generous. We've got names on tree over here. On the generosity tree, we're calling it the generosity tree, with branches of people's name who have passed on from this life to the next. because they're leaving a legacy of generosity. Not just because they were rich. Some of those people had lots of money, and I would consider them rich people. Physically rich, like money rich. And then we have someone like last week's person, Christine Miller. I keep thinking about Larry, the video that you made of her. Here was someone who literally starved to death. She could not swallow. She died because she could not swallow. She couldn't get nourishment into her body. And even from literally her deathbed, she would find the strength to get up and make sandwiches and take them down to the sidewalk, to the streets, so that the people in her neighborhood could eat a sandwich. They wouldn't go hungry that day, even though she was hungry herself. Talk about rich. That wasn't dollar rich. That was heart rich. That was generosity to the nth degree. That was amazing. It's been just in my spirit all week of how many lives. Now, that doesn't happen every day. I'm not saying that happens all the time, because I am human. And I'm still working on Jesus' words in my life. But sometimes I hear that opportunity whisper in my ear. It starts with a whisper. That was one of the taglines of the movie, The Help. It starts with a whisper. Starts with a whisper. The Spirit will speak to our souls. If we keep reminding ourselves that maybe that person needs to hear those words, that they are smart and that they are kind and that they are important. It's not so much how much money we have, it's what we have in our heart for the purpose of that money. It's not even always how we spend it. Uh-oh, did I just say that? It's not whether we have a lot of money or not, and it's not even always how we spend it. It's what is the purpose in our heart. I'm so glad God looks on our hearts and sees things that nobody else can see, because God knows my real intent. If my intent is to bless, if my intent is to be kind, if my intent is to be generous, not so I can get something back. That's part of generosity, is not expecting anything back. Uh-oh. Some of that, I'm not even going to say that. Not even going to say. Y'all have heard enough of that kind of gospel preaching. Here's the thing, it's not about expecting, it's that God will give you back in many different ways, because God is generous with all of us in many ways. It may not come back the same way it went out, but we will be blessed. How often have we said, if I won the lottery, here's what I would do? I've done that. And it's easy for me to make a list. I can tell you right now where I would start. Number one, this church building would be paid off. But that's number two. Number one is I'd pay my tithes. A full 10% on the gross. I'd look at the other places that I've pastored, and if they need money, they would get some money. I would look at some things in our denomination, set up some funds in our denomination so that churches who are struggling don't have to struggle, especially those that have bivocational pastors, so they can get a full-time pastor and not have the pastor doesn't have to work a public job. And I've known several people through the years in my churches that really struggled and sacrificed to bless other people, and they had very little themselves. And I would try to change that. And all kill pet shelters would become no-kill pet shelters. You say, Pastor Keith, you've got a generous heart. Mm-hmm. It's easy for me to tell you all of that because I can't make any of that happen right now. I don't have any of that money in my pocket. Not one bit of those millions. Not one bit of it. So it's easy for me to make a plan now. Now, if I want a million today, I might sit down and reevaluate that thing. I like to think I wouldn't, but who knows? You don't know unless that happens to you. Otherwise, we're just speculating. Here's the thing. If we learn the lessons that Jesus taught us to have a generous heart and to be a kind person and realize that we are important, but also all of those around us are just as important as we are. If we really learn that lesson, then it doesn't matter if we have $1 to share or if we have millions of dollars to share. We will make that happen because we have a generous heart. And Jesus didn't even stop there. And this can go on to a whole nother sermon, which may happen next week. But listen to verse 10, because I think it's important for those of you who have served as pastors, ministers, deacons, good friends, because it's about building friendships. If you're faithful in small scale matters, you'll be faithful with bigger responsibilities. If you're crooked in small responsibilities, you'll be no different in bigger things, Jesus says. If you can't even handle a small thing like money, did Jesus really say that out loud? If you can't even handle a small thing like money, who's going to entrust you with spiritual riches that really matter? If you don't manage well someone else's assets that are entrusted to you, who's going to give to you important spiritual and personal relationships to manage? I told you there's a whole nother sermon than that one. The point is generosity. The point is kindness. The point is there are people out there in the rest of the world that are very clever. Some of our politicians are amazingly clever. I'm not even going to start on that because that's a whole long road. But are amazingly clever. And Jesus says, don't do what they're doing, but take the lesson and turn it into something smart. And instead of politicizing something that they're doing for their own gain, do it to be generous, to bless others. When I look at some of the things going on the news, I'm like, what has happened? Who reared these children? It wasn't the help. Several of y'all just did some Pentecostal cartwheels up and down the aisle in your soul, in your spirits. It wasn't the help. Jesus is here to remind us, and I hope that we all take this home with us. Those of you online, I hope that you take this to heart and you put it into practice. Look for those opportunities to strengthen your friendships. Look for those opportunities of being able to be generous. Look for the opportunities to be kind. And let's listen all this week, and I believe we'll hear the Spirit whispering, because it starts with a whisper, whispering in our ears, you is smart. You is kind. You is important. Amen. Amen.
bless our God forever. I will trust God at all times. God has delivered me from all
is a connection to God, like prayer. Tithing is a kind of communication with God. It's a way for you to show that you know the value of our church, that through giving we are remaining close to God and God's teachings. Tithing is an action, a physical, decisive action that one takes out of the goodness of their hearts. And through this action, those who tithe are offered something very valuable in return, a kind of greatness. So I ask of you today to tithe with me. And I ask you for this coming week, I ask you to meditate. Meditate this week on the way your giving brings you closer to God. Merciful and loving God, we give thanks to you for our congregation, in-house and on the internet as well. God, we thank you for all you do in our lives on a daily basis. God, we ask that you continue to work with us and help the tithes that we receive to be used in all the needs that this church has. God, we thank you just for saying yes to us and allowing us to be in this place that we call home. Amen. As the ushers pass our plates around today, there are so many ways that you can tithe. Okay, that you can tithe. You can tithe by using our app, by writing a check, putting cash in the offering plate, or even sending it in the mail. Thank you.
Just before we go to the prayers of the people, thank you, by the way, for your offerings. Just before we go to the prayers of the people, Desiree wanted to share a little testimony about being generous and kind. She may not have described it that way, but when she was telling me, I felt that in my spirit. So share with us about your mom.
Yes. Hi, everyone. My name is Desiree. I'll make this fast. My mom died 2 days ago. She was 94. The backstory is, 2 months ago, she fell, broke a hip, went to Culver City Hospital, 2 weeks there, went to rehabilitation in Mar Vista. Another couple weeks later, she came home to where she lives in assisted living and tried to get out of bed and fell again, went to UCLA, then came back to assisted living. All that time, I would visit every other day or every day if I had wanted to or could be able to. So I was there quite a bit. I used this opportunity as a growth process. I didn't do so well with my father dying. There was not a lot of communication. He was very withdrawn. It was like saying, I drew this picture. What do you think of this picture? Oh, that's nice. Back with the newspaper. So these kind of things tend to go from generation to generation. And I wanted to stop that right there. Back to my mom. I would hold her hand. I would stroke her hair. I would say things to her. But she, as the doctors at UCLA said, she is shutting down inner systems of hers. But she rallied about two Fridays ago, and she was talking to me. I was talking to her. She didn't have the use of her lips, but she aspirated the words, and I got most of them, but not all of them. She stroked my hair and said, I miss my boy. I know, Mom, I understand. And she said, he was always lonely, referring to my father. I understood that. Yes, Mom, I understand that. We were talking that one day, and I became aware that she was describing heaven, what she was seeing. Her face had awe on it. Her arms were seeing what was physical and what was not physical. Oh, there's the wall. And then there was a show of contrition or humbleness like this. And I followed what she was doing and encouraged her, talked to her about, ask questions. Is my father there? Is your husband? Is my late brother Richard, is your parents, my grandparents there? What are you seeing? So I've got a lot of good answers from that, and that was what happened. Very interesting and very revealing. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing, Desiree. Our prayers and sympathy to you. I'd like to remind probably all the online people to be sure and have their bread and cup handy as we, and join us in communion. The COVID candle still burns. It burns because the lessons of the pandemic are clearly not over, and now there's monkeypox. We still need to learn vigilance, learn ministry to the sick, and to learn support for staying healthy. We also now need to learn how to return to a loving community and how and to be the gospel of the future. So, for now, the COVID candle still burns. Let us pray. Loving God, we bless your name for making us smarter than we think we are, and for sending us off to figure things out in a way that will glorify you. Yes, God, we is smart, but not smart enough to live without violence, nor not smart enough to nurture creation with care, not smart enough to learn each other's pronoun. Yes, God, we is kind, but not kind enough to embrace your problem children, not kind enough to stop saying, not in my neighborhood, not kind enough to examine the causes of conflict. But yes, God, we is important enough to make a difference, important enough to save a sibling, important enough to save the world. And so we say yes, God, to the cleverness of your spirit. Yes, to the opportunities for compassion. Yes, to a life of unbounded generosity. God, we say yes to your unbroken cycle of giving and receiving. Amen. In MCC, we have an open table. Membership is not required, and everyone is welcome. Our many tables everywhere become one table with this. All are celebrants of the feast. Our many tables have now become one table. As a part of the priesthood of all believers, everyone gathered at this table, made of our many tables, is invited to join us as celebrants in the feast of our God. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus presented his assets in bread and cup. He lifted this piece of bread, he blessed it, broke it, and invited us to do likewise. So we lift our bread, bless it, and break it together. As Jesus says, this is my body for you to manage. To be Christ's wise accountants, we do this. God, consecrate this bread that we might learn clearer lessons. Thank you for making us Christ's body. Let us consume. When all had eaten, Jesus took the sacred cup and shared the responsibility with all his disciples. So with him, we raise our cups and bless them. As we hear Jesus saying, this is my blood, entrusted to you to build a mighty network of relationships. We do this. God, consecrate this cup that we might choose you over money. Thank you for giving us Christ's orders. Let us consume together. God, we are filled in body, heart, and soul. Thank you for the joy alive at this table. Thank you for the bond that lasts when the meal is over. Amen.
Say thank you for being with us in worship today. I hope that you have been blessed, whether you're on site or off site. We welcome the worship together and appreciate this time that we have together. Before we sing our last song and pray the benediction, we do want to say a special thank you to Jennifer Eagle, our signer today. And we want to wish John Lensingham, a happy birthday, because one of our ushers is having his birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear John. Happy birthday to you.
To watch those other sneaky ushers. They'll tell on you. Would you rise as you're able and join us in our closing song?
I want to say a quick thanks to Ava for joining on the music.
Thank you. No, thank you.
Who also picked all the songs today, too. Thank you. You can press a drum machine, please.
From you alone, my Lord and my salvation. Your praise is always on my lips. Your word is living in my heart. And I will praise you with a new song. My soul will bless you, Lord. You fill my life with greater joy. Yes, I delight myself in you. And I will praise you with a new song. You, Lord, and I am weak, you make me strong. When I'm poor, I know I'm rich, for in the power of your name, all things are possible. All things are possible. Your praise is always on my lips. Your word is living in my heart, song. My soul will bless you, Lord. You fill my life with greater joy. Yes, I delight myself in you. And I will praise you, new song. My soul will bless you, Lord.
When I am weak, you make me strong. When I'm poor, I know I'm rich and in the power of your name. All things are possible. 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 All things are possible.
Amen. And we'll, if you will pray with me this morning, thank you, God, for this time we've had together. We know that all things are possible, even changes in our own lives. God, you can make us even kinder than we ever thought we were, more generous than we ever thought we would be, and help us to remember we're always important to you. We pray that you will bless us as we go out from this place this week, that we also are building a legacy of generosity, that we will bless others in this life and beyond. We ask that you will minister to us and through us as we go out into a world that needs us. We ask in the name of Jesus our Christ and all that is holy. Amen.
Amen.
Have a wonderful week and God bless you.